Each week, I host one or two forums in the district on topics vital to your life. Here's a tape of one of those forums.
Welcome, and a little bit of personal background so you understand where I'm coming from with regard to long-term care, because it hit my family double-barreled. I want to thank you coming out on a beautiful, oh, we have one more person coming in. On a beautiful day like this, most people are on the golf course or maybe heading down to Jones Beach, but you took a little time out of your schedule to come and learn about long-term care. The first question is, how many people in the room have long-term care insurance now? One, two, three, four. Okay, that's do. Okay, so that's one, two, three, four, five, six. That's actually almost 25% of the audience, which is very high. Statistically, only 7% of Americans who should buy long-term care actually own a policy. So this is a very informed group. What's been happening with long-term care over the last couple of years is a lot of changes, especially with regard to premiums and benefits, which we had a conversation earlier about. As a result, many people who already own a policy want to become re-informed. They might have bought a policy 10, 12, 15 years ago. My wife and I bought our policy about 15 years ago, before a lot of the insurance companies actually exited the business. Has anybody seen news reports where large insurance companies have decided to stop selling long-term care insurance? Anybody? Okay, we got one. Well, when I first started focusing on long-term care in my financial planning practice in 1993, it was the year that Senator Hannon sponsored the New York State Partnership Plan up in Albany. New York State was one of three states that took funding, charitable funding, from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. The foundation was trying to come up with another vehicle for paying for long-term care other than Medicaid. Pretty much everybody universally knows that Medicaid will pay for long-term care. If you are impoverished, you qualify for Medicaid, and it will pay for the nursing home. The states are going broke because basically half of the Medicaid budget is from the federal government, the other half is from the state. In New York State, 25% is the county, 25% is the state, and 50% is the federal government. So it's a tremendous financial burden on the government agencies that are managing Medicaid. So Robert Wood Johnson came up with this funding, and Indiana, Connecticut, and New York took advantage of the funding, and they all came up with some strategies to find a way of transferring the financial risk away from Medicaid onto the private insurance industry. And it was very successful. New York State was the first state to have a partnership plan. It passed in 1993, as I mentioned, and today, I always say imitation is the greatest form of flattery, because now there are 43 states that have partnership plans. And in a nutshell, what the partnership plan does is it actually is a partnership. That's why they call it the partnership plan. It's a partnership between the consumer, the insurance industry, and Medicaid. It's a three-legged stool, and everybody benefits. If you buy a New York State partnership plan certified by the state of New York, the insurance company is obligated to pay for your care when you qualify. If you are alive and still needing benefits after you've consumed the entire policy, which happens, many people are living beyond the length of their long-term care policy, maybe 3 or 4 years, and then they're still breathing and they still need care, so they burned through $500,000 of insurance benefits. Then, if you have the partnership plan, you qualify for Medicaid without transferring your assets, without impoverishing yourself. So it's a way of protecting your assets as well as protecting it protects your nest egg, but it also protects your family, so you're not now shifted to having family members take care of you when your long-term care insurance policy runs out. Now, about a year and a half ago, New York State was the only state to have what's called total asset long-term care protection under the partnership plan. That means you could have $20 million in the bank and go on Medicaid. Okay, all the other states, all the other 43 states have something called dollar for dollar partnership plans. That means if the pool of money in your long-term care policy is $500,000, it's only going to protect $500,000 of assets. So there was always a real concern by New Yorkers, what happens if I move to Florida, which is a pretty common thing. Well, last year, about 18 months ago, there was an agreement by all the partnership states. There is now reciprocity. So you can take your New York State partnership plan and go anywhere among the 43 states that have a partnership plan and qualify for Medicaid if you blow through your policy. It's very rare for somebody to usually go through all their policy benefits, but if it does happen, you want the safety net of the federal state government under Medicaid to pay your bills. So that's kind of a nutshell of how I got involved in long-term care. But long-term care has evolved over the last 15 years or so. Insurance companies initially did a very bad job of estimating the premiums. Most of the companies that are offering long-term care insurance are traditionally life insurance companies, not health insurance companies. And life insurance companies have wonderful statistics going back to about the 1700s on mortality. So if they're doing a calculation of what to charge for life insurance, they have mortality tables from the federal government to tell, they can tell the insurance company exactly how long you're going to live, so they know how to price the policy for life insurance. Well, the problem with long-term care insurance, and we were having this conversation earlier with some of the other folks that got here early, it's different than life insurance. Think about this. When you buy life insurance as a young person, you're typically buying large amounts of death benefit to protect against an early death, you know, the proverbial getting hit by the bus crossing the street. So you buy lots of life insurance. Typically, it's term insurance. You want to make sure your family has enough money to pay the mortgage, get the kids through college. But typically, as we get older and older, we let our life insurance policies go. We don't really need to protect the mortgage if it's paid off. We don't need to pay for the college education because our kids are now, you know, having their own kids. They're out of college. So very large percentage of life insurance policies never pay a death benefit. It's a very profitable business for the life insurance companies because they collect premiums for many, many years. And you're basically making sure that you have peace of mind. You have what I call sleep insurance, where if you die at a young age, your kids are going to go to college, your mortgage is going to get paid off. But when you're in your early 60s and you're anticipating retirement, your mortgage is gone, your kids are having their own kids, so you let the insurance go. So when they started pricing long-term care, they started calculating high lapse ratio. A lapse is when you let your policy go. So the insurance companies that had a lot of history of life insurance were saying, well, we'll probably have 50% of these policies under long-term care go away because people will stop paying the premiums. Just the opposite has happened. I've had people with 50% rate increases on their long-term care plans hang on to it to dear life, because as you get older and older, you realize you're going to need this. You see all your friends and your family members needing long-term care. So the lapse ratio on long-term care is less than 2%. The lapse ratio on term life insurance is about 90%. So the insurance companies did not charge enough money back 20 years ago when they first started offering long-term care. The other thing that's been a major problem for the insurance companies and also for the banks, has anybody put money in a CD recently? What do they offer you at the bank? 0.5% for 5 years or some ridiculous? Or you have to pay that. In Japan, they have negative interest rates. You put money in the bank in Japan, they have a negative interest rate in Japan. You have to pay them to hold your money. So if you're a retired person or you're close to retirement, you're focused on safe, predictable income. You want to have things like CDs, money market accounts, maybe some treasury bonds or some municipal bonds. You're not investing in the stock market anymore for growth. So the biggest problem now, because we've had almost 10 years with almost 0% interest, it's been a big burden for savers. People who traditionally save and plan for retirement are not getting anything on their money unless they're willing to take a lot of risk in the stock market or, you know, some sort of a real estate investment. So as a result, the insurance companies are kind of in a bind because all the plans that were sold in the past, if you were working with a good financial advisor in the past, the advisor would say, well, healthcare costs typically rise at about twice the inflation rate. So they want to make sure your policy, if you buy a policy in your 40s or 50s for long-term care, you're probably not going to use it for 25 or 30 years. This is a statistic that most people get blown away at. The average age for somebody using their long-term care policy, can anybody guess how old they would be, the average person going on claim for long-term care insurance? 83. We're all living longer. We're living healthier lives. So people who bought a policy in their 50s are going to pay premiums for 30, 35 years before they collect the benefits. So the insurance companies are in a situation now where they collect premiums from everybody who owns a policy. And what do they go out and buy? What does an insurance company buy with that money? For the vast majority of insurance companies, they're buying treasury bonds. Very conservative portfolios. As a matter of fact, they're restricted by state regulations. They can't invest in risky things. So what is a treasury bond? A 10-year treasury is paying 1.8% right now. So now they have a pool of policies that were sold over the last 20 years with 5% compound inflation built in. My policy that I bought, every year it's growing at 5%. But the insurance company is earning 1.8% on their portfolio, but they got to keep raising my benefit. Even when I'm on claim, if I go on claim tomorrow, they got to keep raising my benefit 5% because that's the contract they sold me. So as a result, large numbers of high-quality, well-known insurance companies have actually left the insurance business for long-term care. They still sell life insurance, they still say disability, they still say homeowners and auto insurance, but long-term care has been a losing proposition for the insurance industry for 20 years. MetLife has exited, Prudential has exited, Travelers has exited, all the names that you probably recognize, all the television advertising you've seen. So there's only a handful of companies that are still actually offering long-term care. Probably the most important thing in this presentation are the last eight slides that I'm going to go through. In the last maybe 4 or 5 years, there's been a tremendous transition from traditional long-term care insurance to what we call linked policies. A linked policy is actually a life insurance policy with a long-term care benefit added to it. And it's very attractive for consumers because very frequently when I'm working with somebody who's thinking about buying long-term care insurance, they'll say, what happens if I pay premiums for 25 or 30 years and I have the good fortune of dying in my sleep and I never need care? I paid those premiums for nothing. And the obvious answer to that is, well, you've paid premiums for your homeowner's insurance and your auto insurance, and that's basically it's insurance, it's peace of mind. Well, the link benefits kind of are unique because they have a guaranteed benefit regardless of whether you need care or not. If you do have the good fortune of going to heaven while you're sleeping one night, the life insurance goes to your kids or to your grandkids. So you pay premiums for a policy that's always going to pay a benefit, whether it's a life insurance benefit or a long-term care benefit. So the linked benefits are really now where most consumers are going, even though there are still traditional long-term care plans available. I don't want to co-opt a lot of my slides, but I'm going to start the slide presentation, and it should take maybe only 15 or 20 minutes to run through the slides, but at that point, I'm going to open it up to questions because that's probably the most valuable part of a presentation like this, is having the opportunity to ask questions from somebody who's been doing this for about 20 years. Okay? Let me turn my little projector on here. If you don't mind. I'll just take my little Canon takes a minute to warm up. But I'm trying to save the bulb. I didn't want to leave it on the whole time. The projectors are a couple hundred dollars. I think the bulbs are about a couple hundred dollars. A little stingy with my bulbs. Okay, here we go. I think the light switch is right behind you, Gail. Can you all see this? It's kind of a little washed out because of the lights. Okay. What I'm going to try and cover today are some key questions. First of all, what is long-term care? Can anybody give me a cogent explanation of what long-term care is? Not the insurance, but the long-term care. Has anybody been a caregiver? Has anybody provided care for a family member in the room? Okay. Are you currently providing care or did you provide care? Both. So define long-term care. Everything. That's the single best word. You always know somebody's a caregiver when they say everything, because you have to do feeding, bathing, dressing, toileting, linens, the whole nine yards. So long-term care, especially in the home environment, is really tedious. And typically what happens is the caregivers suffer more than the person receiving the care. I see a lot of heads nodding when I say that. And I have a personal experience right here in Garden City. My mother-in-law, who is now in heaven, she had serious health issues for many, many years, and one Sunday we were having dinner at the dining room table and she started complaining about her back. Now, women may or may not know this, but back pain is actually a warning of heart disease. Men have it in the chest, women have it in the back. My wife had back pain for about 2 or 3 years until we realized that she needed triple bypass surgery. So back pain in women, clamminess, sweatiness, a little nausea, sometimes you get a little pain in your left arm. My mother-in-law was having a heart attack, probably her third or fourth heart attack. We were having Sunday dinner. I said, Florence, we're going to Winthrop. She wouldn't let me call an ambulance, so I put her in my car, drove her up to Winthrop Hospital, pulled into the emergency room, grabbed a wheelchair, brought her in, said, 84 chest pains. They jumped on her like white on rice, okay? After about 3 or 4 days, she was stabilized in the hospital. They said, you have 4 coronary arteries that are almost completely blocked. They did an echocardiogram. So now the big decision was, what do we do? My younger daughter was actually in medical school at the time, and she said to her grandma, you know, Florence, I just want you to know what they're going to do to you. They're going to open up your chest. They're going to split your chest open. They're going to stop your heart. They're going to strip blood vessels out of your leg, and then they're going to re-plumb, new plumbing on your heart. And she wanted to really give her the graphic details because she thought at 84 it might not be a really good idea to do that surgery. She might not come out of the surgery. Well, Florence was a trooper, and she decided on her own that she wanted the surgery. She came out of it like a trooper. She did really well in the surgery, and we're getting ready to go pick her up from the hospital 4 or 5 days later, and we walk into her room, and she's slumped over. Massive stroke. Blood clot from the leg went to the brain. They hadn't installed a Greenfield filter in her groin, which is now pretty much procedure. Massive stroke. Now, one of my best friends from high school was a social worker working at Winthrop University. And Nancy said, take Florence down to Bryn Mawr. Bryn Mawr, Pennsylvania is the best place on the East Coast for anybody who has had a stroke or any brain injury. Now, this brings up another statistic, which is really, really interesting. Does anybody have a clue what the percentage of people in a rehab facility, what percentage are under age 40? Oh, I'm sorry, under age 65. 40% of people under 65 are in rehab facilities from car accidents, motorcycle accidents, trampoline accidents. So my 84-year-old mother-in-law, her roommate was a 24-year-old kid. So anyway, Medicare paid for the first 100 days, thankfully, for her treatment at Bryn Mawr down in Philadelphia. But then Medicare stops paying. It was $1,000 a day for the rehab. So we brought her home to Garden City. My sister-in-law, who was single and lived with her mom, she worked at TWA at LaGuardia. Does anybody remember what happened to TWA? American Airlines bought them out. It was just at that time. So she had 20 years experience. They were going to keep her at TWA, but she'd have to go out to St. Louis to learn their systems at American Airlines for about a month or two. She said, I'm not going. So she stayed home to take care of her mom. She gave up her pension and her health insurance and her salary. And her mom lived for 10 years. The care was so good, she didn't have one bed sore for 10 years. So now, 94 years old, she goes to heaven. My sister-in-law, who is in her late 50s now, has no contributions to a pension plan, hasn't had health insurance for 10 years, no dental insurance. She's got to start her whole life over again. So caregiving is much more burdensome than just the heavy lifting. It's a financial burden to the family, and that's one of the other reasons why people look at this. So that's a good definition of what long-term care is. Long-term care insurance is basically a free enterprise system of transferring the risk from your own pocketbook, your own checkbook, to an insurance company. The biggest question, which we already talked about before, is how to qualify for benefits. This is where the federal government finally got involved in the insurance industry. I had a conversation with this young lady in the front row earlier about regulations. The banking industry, the securities industry are all regulated by the feds. The insurance industry historically has always been regulated by the states. There really is no regulation on the insurance business from the federal government until long-term care. There were so many abuses with regard to these long-term care policies where the language was so involved, so convoluted, that large numbers of people who had paid policies for many, many years couldn't collect their benefits. So in 1993, the federal government stepped in and they passed a law that said these are the triggers for benefits, and I'll get into them in specifics in a second. And if the insurance company has sold a policy any place in the United States, the regulations are the same. It doesn't matter whether you're in Florida or in New York or any place else. So it's important to understand that today the policies that are being sold are controlled both by the state of New York and also by the federal government. Well, basically long-term care is, we already talked about it, it's the social and medical services provided by either family members or professionals for chronic illness. Sometimes long-term care is a short treatment. It depends on the type of illness or injury. If it's not a chronic illness, you might receive long-term care for 6 months or a year. after hip replacement or knee replacement, you might be able to collect on your policy. And sometimes it's a one-way trip to the nursing home. So long-term care really can be run the gamut of a very short-term level of treatment to a lifetime of treatment. The skills, pretty much everything we said before, personal care, homemaking services. It includes physical therapy. Very frequently, somebody who's confined to the home is being received by several professionals on a weekly basis. Kemp, you want to say something? Come on.
Good morning. I just wanted to welcome you all here. I'm glad you're here because this is probably one of the biggest challenges in health policy that exists, long-term care. And you have one of the finest people to describe this that we have in all of Long Island, maybe even greater.
Thank you, sir.
We've been doing it for a while, but it is something that we spend lots of time at, and the direct things that Ray will be talking about in terms of the insurance is something that all government, state, national, has not been able to address because it's so costly. But there's a lot of other steps that can be taken. You're going to hear about those lot of other steps. And if you have any suggestions as to what we want to be talking about or not talking about, what future programs we could do, we'd love to hear from them. It's nice to see you all this morning with several friends here in the audience. What a day. It's finally spring.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Kemp.
Thank you, Ray. Thank you for doing this.
All right. My pleasure.
I have to be three places at once.
Thanks. Well, I before you got in, Kemp, I gave credit for the fact that you were the boy up in Albany that got this thing through back in 93. It was New York was the first to have a partnership plan because of you.
Doing it long enough, we now have to improve or change what we've already done.
Yeah, we got to modify the plans, and that's what we're going to talk about this morning.
Great.
Thanks, Kemp. Appreciate it. Thank you for your leadership. Quite honestly, New York was the role model for the rest of the country, and so I'm really honored to be able to help Kemp get the word out. One of the other issues with regard to state government budgets. I got a prop up here. This is a booklet that was printed by the state of New York 10 years ago. There's no budget to reprint this. This is the description of the New York State Partnership Plan. We had a conversation about things being outdated and, you know, the tax laws keep changing. Well, the partnership plan has been going through some changes, but it's still available. So we'll talk a little bit about that. But the most attractive thing about the partnership plan is it's really truly a partnership between the consumer, the insurance industry, and also the state government through Medicaid. Okay, so now the setting. Where do you receive your care? Obviously, almost anywhere. There are large growth industries called assisted living facilities. You've probably all seen the Bristol and some of these other facilities growing up on Long Island. That's a tremendous growth industry because there are a large number of retired folks that don't want to continue to deal with the snow removal and the mowing and the lawns, and they don't have any health issues. They just want to go someplace where they can, you know, have a comfortable environment, social activities, cocktail hours. I mean, the Bristol is phenomenal. I go there all the time. I have a number of clients that live there. So it's a nice alternative. But then very often what happens is you make a transition from not needing assistance to needing assistance, and you're in the right setting. And there are actually some nursing homes that have three or four levels of care. So you can go there not really requiring much care and then gradually be transferred to different divisions. My mom lived in a wonderful nursing home up in Connecticut, in Greenwich, Connecticut. It was the Greenwich Woods Nursing Facility. And she had the good fortune of living 7 years in a nursing home. And of course, unfortunately, she didn't do any planning, and this is prior to me getting involved in this. She was a great lady, but she grew up kind of lower middle class and didn't have a lot of money when she was younger, so anything she had, she wanted to hang on, even though in those days the transfer rules were very, very lenient. You could actually transfer assets, and within 12 to 18 months, you could qualify for Medicaid. Now we have a five-year look back for transfers to get onto Medicaid. But she didn't want to give anything away, and as a result, after 7 years in Greenwich Woods, she went through $900,000. She could have put all of her 13 grandkids through college, but she spent her money, which was her money, on her care, and she went to heaven after qualifying for Medicaid for about 3 months. So she actually went up Medicaid when she ran out of money. The other thing that a lot of people are concerned about is if you do qualify for Medicaid after being a private paying patient, they cannot transfer you to another section of the nursing home. They cannot put you in a different room. The nursing homes today will lose their Medicaid license if they treat you differently once you qualify for Medicaid. So Medicaid is not as bad an issue unless you're trying to get into the nursing home as a Medicaid qualified person. Then it becomes difficult because there's only so many beds in each one of these facilities. Now remember, most nursing homes, with the exception of a handful, which are run by the nuns, most of them are for-profit businesses. So if they're getting reimbursed half what it costs them for a nursing home bed by Medicaid, they're only going to have a few Medicaid beds available, and they only come available when somebody passes away. So you don't want to go to a nursing home already qualified for Medicaid. You want to be a private paying patient and then eventually maybe qualify for Medicaid after that. But the settings can be right in your home. And quite honestly, most people much prefer to be in their own home because it's comfortable, it's private, they're surrounded by their loved ones. They did a survey, the Department of Health and Human Services did a survey recently about where people wanted to receive care, and they found that over 70% of people enumerated the fact that they would much prefer to stay at home as long as the services can be provided that they need. And the level of home care services now have grown rapidly. You know, it used to be in the old days, you know, you'd have a hospital bed and maybe an oxygen tank, but now you can convert your living room into a nursing home. And it's actually much more cost effective to stay at home than to go to a facility. So it's much more practical. And of course, you're in your own environment and you have the privacy of your family visiting you without having to go to a nursing home. So most people want to stay at home. And that's one of the big benefits of long-term care insurance or one of these new linked life insurance plans, is it pays benefits regardless of where you receive care. So if you're getting care at home, the insurance company will pay for it. You don't have to go to a nursing home. Okay, long-term care insurance, we've been talking a lot about it. I can skip this slide. The only thing I would mention, and this is something that the insurance companies have gotten very, very strict about, all life insurance and long-term care insurance is based on the age when you apply. In other words, they figure out the premium based on how old you are. There also is medical underwriting for both life insurance and long-term care insurance, but the medical underwriting for long-term care has gotten much more onerous. I've been selling policies, like I said, for almost 20 years now, and it used to be if you could fog a mirror, they'd give you a policy. I mean, it was really that easy. Now there's medical exams, they want to get a record of all your doctor's visits, so it's much more difficult to qualify. So if you have some pre-existing conditions, you may not actually qualify. So I try and counsel people to do it as young as possible. Because your premium is lower based on your age, but also the likelihood of qualifying is much higher. This year I've already had about 5 or 6 people that were declined for coverage. Now this is probably the most important slide, and if you want to take any notes or just remember one thing, this slide here is how do you qualify for benefits. This goes back to my comments before about the federal government getting involved. It's your doctor, not the insurance company's doctor, it's your doctor that certifies that you need help with 2 out of 6 activities of daily living, or you have cognitive impairment which requires supervision. Those are the 2 triggers. You don't have to qualify for both, one or the other. And in the legislation, the federal legislation, they even enumerate the 6 activities, the bathing, dressing, toileting, transferring, continence, and eating. So if your doctor says, for example, you need help with bathing and dressing, which probably are the first 2 that go, it's kind of interesting, as you get older and you need care, it's kind of the reverse of when you were a baby. You get what I'm saying? When you were a baby, somebody had to feed you and bathe you and dress you. So as you get older, the things that go away the first are the things you needed the most when you were an infant. So the federal government now dictates that regardless of where you bought your policy, the trigger for benefits are the same. And the insurance company cannot weasel out of paying claims as long as you need 2 out of 6 or you're cognitively impaired. Any questions on that? That's very important. Okay. This statistic is pretty powerful. When I first started doing it, the number was 50%. Now it's 70%. The risk of needing care, because we're living longer, we have a healthier lifestyle, once we reach 65, normal retirement age, almost 3 out of 4 of us are going to need some form of care. That doesn't mean you're going to be carted off to a nursing home, but you're probably going to have your kids get you some groceries or do some cooking, maybe do the laundry. It's a gradual progression, but think about this. What's the likelihood of driving out here on Stewart Avenue and having an accident? It's not 70%. Same thing with your house. When was the last time your house burned down? Very low liability for big, big risks. Our biggest risk is not a car accident or a house burning down. It's blowing through your whole life savings, your nest egg, by having a long-term care event. And 3 out of 4 of us are going to need it. Now, you can rely on family members. The other statistic, which I mentioned before, 40% of people receiving care are under 65. So it's not just the old folks in the nursing homes. These are the costs in this area. I've just updated this slide recently. Per day in a facility, I don't know, has anybody visited a nursing home recently? Any loved ones? Okay, we got a couple loved ones visiting. Probably one of the nicest places on Long Island is out in Suffolk County. You ever hear of Gerwin? Gerwin is a Jewish nursing home out in Suffolk County. They have the distinct honor of being the most expensive on Long Island. A semi-private room is north of $15,000 a month. So we're talking $180,000 a year for a nursing home, and somewhere about half of that for home care, depending on the level of care you need and how frequently you need somebody to come into the house. So the numbers are inflation hasn't stopped. Even though our economy is growing along at 1.5 to 2%, healthcare inflation and higher education inflation, where you talk about these kids coming out of college with all the student debt and they don't get jobs, same thing, health insurance and higher education insurance, higher education expenses have been growing at twice the rate of inflation for the last 20 years. So costs aren't getting less, they're getting higher. So for example, if you're growing something at 5%, it will double in 15 years. So if it costs $180,000 today, 15 years from now, it's going to be double that. Okay, home care, depending on the type of care you need, obviously, if you need a couple hours a day. Registered nurses very infrequently will be caregivers. You might need a registered nurse to do a B12 injection or, you know, come and take a blood sample. But for the most part, you're going to be paying about $20 an hour for a home health aide. We're very fortunate in New York, believe it or not, with regard to home health aides. If you go to some other areas of the country where we don't have mass transit and we don't have large populations of immigrants, home health aides are very rare. They're very hard to find. In New York, we have mass transit. We have a lot of people here from other countries who are willing to work for $8.50 an hour. It says here $20 an hour, but you're going through an agency. The agency pays the actual hardworking person $8.50 an hour to do the work. So $20 an hour is what you're going to shell over out of your checking account to take somebody into your home for a couple of hours a day. But the aide only gets $8 an hour. Okay. We talked a little bit about government programs. We know that if we don't do any planning at all, we're going to either have our family pay for it or our own checkbook. You know, we can go through our nest egg. Government programs are, quite honestly, totally misunderstood. I wish I knew who it was that named Medicare and Medicaid when they first became programs, because I have so many clients, and maybe some of you folks in this room, they use the terms interchangeably, Medicare and Medicaid. It's like the same program. It's not. Medicare is health insurance that you pay for. I'm on Medicare. For three years I've been on Medicare. I pay a premium to the federal government for my Medicare. It's health insurance, Part A, Part B, Part D. Medicaid is actually welfare. It's government assistance for the poor. But people think they're the same program. Medicare does provide up to 100 days in a nursing facility if it's medically necessary care, not custodial care. And if you and the first 20 days, there's no deductible. From day 21 up to 100, there's about $120 a day deductible or copay for Medicare. Now, that first of all, you have to qualify. You have to have a three-day stay in a hospital. Then the care in the nursing home or the rehab facility must be medically necessary. And if you plateau, if the doctor says that after the stroke you're not improving after the 17th or 18th day, Medicare stops paying. So if you're lucky, you get 100 days from Medicare for a facility. But it has to be medically necessary care, not bathing and dressing and toileting and all the other things we call custodial care. The other category is Medicaid. Now, Medicaid is where all the elder law attorneys focus. I have a couple of close friends who are attorneys, and they specialize in helping people pretend to be poor. That's basically what Medicaid is. If you do Medicaid planning with an elder law attorney right here on Franklin Avenue, they're going to sit you down and they're going to say, okay, give me a list of all your assets. We're going to create an irrevocable trust. We're going to have you transfer your assets into the irrevocable trust. And then you have to stay healthy for 5 years because there's a 5-year look back on all the gifts. Or if you're very magnanimous, you can give all your assets to your kids, but you still have a 5-year look back. If you don't use the trust, you can actually make gifts to your children. So Medicaid planning has become much more difficult. When I first started doing these seminars, when my mom was in the nursing home, the look back period was 12 months. then the government raised it to 18 months because they figured out people are taking advantage of Medicaid by just giving away their money. So then they made it 30 months and then 36 months. Now it's 60 months. So if you do a Medicaid trust now, what they call an irrevocable Medicaid trust, number one, you give up control of your assets. You can't take the assets out of the trust. It has to be irrevocably given away. You do take the income from the trust, but you can't take the assets back out again. And you have to stay healthy for 5 years to qualify for Medicaid. And then if you qualify for Medicaid, then you have to deal with all the nursing homes who don't have many beds qualified for nursing, for people who are already qualified for Medicaid. You got a question?
Supplemental needs trust.
Supplemental needs trust is designed for people who have a handicap. And it's designed so that people don't lose their family benefits. If you have an adult child, for example, who has autism, you set up a supplemental needs trust, or they call it a special needs trust. Then the money can go for their benefit, but only the income goes to their benefit, not the principal. And it also prevents them from losing their SSDI or some of their government benefits. If a handicapped adult person receives an inheritance from their parents, all of a sudden they now have assets that the social services can go after. So a special needs or a supplemental needs trust is different than an irrevocable trust, and it's for a different purpose. Yes?
I think one of the critical things about that is you can't do it for someone who's over 65.
That's true. There's a lawyer in the room. I'm only a financial advisor. There's a lawyer in the room, and you can't do a supplemental needs trust when somebody's reached 65. thank you for the input. okay, and then the other, yes? It's the attending physician in the facility, probably a rehab facility, very often after a stroke or something like that. They have to report to Medicaid on a daily basis your progress. And it's called plateauing. My mother-in-law is a prime example. She got a full 100 days in the nursing home, but she kept getting better all the way through the 100 days. The report was she's taking three sessions of physical therapy, two sessions of speech therapy. She got her swallow reflex back. She got her speech back. All the things that we were trying to accomplish were working, and the therapy was working. But if you're in a rehab facility in the 17th or the 21st or whatever day, and the doctor says, well, there's been no progress, then Medicare stops paying. And then you either pay privately or bring that person home. So and it's the government. That's the rules. And also, remember, it's got to be medically necessary care, like therapy. It can't be just, you know, helping somebody go to the bathroom. Okay? Okay, so basically the transfer the risk. That's basically what we've been talking about since we started. Buying either a long-term care insurance policy or one of these new life insurance policies that has a long-term care benefit. Very few people have done it. One of the reasons why it's necessary today, we have much smaller families. I have the distinction of having a big family. I have 4 kids and 8 grandkids, but a lot of people are having very, very small families. And also, quite honestly, the families are scattered. I have 2 kids that live in Virginia and 5 grandchildren down in Virginia. So my wife and I are certainly not going to count on them to take care of us later on in life. Also, in the old days, I always like to use the neighborhood of Brooklyn, because a lot of folks, actually, their ancestors all came out of Brooklyn. Let's say in Bed-Stuy, before it got to be a bad neighborhood, you'd have the first floor was grandma and grandpa, the second floor was mom and dad, and then when the kids got married, they got the third floor. And they all lived in the same house. There was always somebody around to take care of somebody. If somebody had a stroke or somebody had some issues to deal with, they were family members. The families are scattered and they're smaller, and also women work today. I mean, there's very few families, except maybe a few in Garden City, where you see, the typical Ozzie and Harriet family where mom stays at home and raises the kids. Women are outside working. So they have to, like my sister-in-law, she had to give up her job at TWA to take care of her mom because there was nobody else to do it. Okay, we talked a lot about Medicare and Medicaid. I don't want to beat a dead horse, but basically you cannot count on government services. The best you might get is 100 days in a nursing home from Medicare. And you can get 100% of your costs paid for by Medicaid welfare, but you have to have no money. And it's either spend down your whole life savings, your whole nest egg, to get on Medicaid, or go to an elder law attorney and transfer all your assets. Yes?
Once you reach that 100-day plateau,
Well, that is true, but you're mixing Medicare and Medicaid there. Medicare has a 100-day benefit in the nursing home. If you have a couple who has a house, let's say a house in Garden City, or they have a condo, they're not going to force the well spouse, what we call the community spouse, to impoverish themselves. So a car and a house and a certain amount of money, a very small amount of money, is allowed to qualify for Medicaid. However, all states have recovery laws. That means once the person goes to heaven, and it's not the first spouse, it's the second spouse, they're not going to impoverish the surviving spouse. Let's say the widow is now living in the house. They're not going to take her house away, but when she goes to heaven, social services has a record of all the expenses they outlaid for that sick person. They do a recovery. It's called an estate recovery, and that's law in every state. So if you do qualify for Medicaid and still have your house, eventually you got to figure that a good portion of the equity in the house is going to be taken away, and it's not going to go to your loved ones. It's not going to be part of your estate. So it's not a good plan. That's what happens when people don't plan. Okay, we talked about out-of-pocket risk. I'm not going to. A lot of these slides are redundant. This is basically about $80,000 a year for home care, $180,000 for nursing home care. Your options. When you have long-term care insurance, basically you can insure where you have the care given, who provides the care. You have the guarantee of quality of care because you basically have an insurance company backing you up. Incidentally, that's one of the other benefits of long-term care insurance that most people don't know. They provide a registered nurse to develop a plan of care, and they supervise the plan of care going on. So as opposed to being a private paying patient or family member dealing with a home health care agency, now you have an insurance company that's supervising the whole process and making sure there's a written plan of care. That's a benefit that really helps a lot of folks. You also maintain your independence, protect your life savings. You're going to support you're not going to go through your life savings and leave your widow impoverished. And again, the last line here, relieve the burden of your loved ones. The biggest complaint I have from families when they're going through this without having done the planning is that the sick person really is kind of, may not even be aware of what's going on, but the children, the adult children, are fighting with each other. The daughter usually winds up getting stuck doing all the work. The brother says, oh, I'm too busy, I'm traveling on business. So the biggest reason, I think, if you have adult children, to have long-term care insurance is so the kids don't fight when you need care. Basically, that's what it is. There's peace in the family. Before I start questions, I wanted to show you a couple of, there's only a few slides on the second presentation. Let me go to this one. This is a brand new slide presentation that I just put together for today. And it's very timely because of what we were talking about before. This is what we call life insurance and long-term care together, linked together. And that's my information there, but I'll give you business cards if you're interested later on. Okay. I work with baby boomers and their parents, 30 years experience. Okay, you don't need to see that. Okay, going the wrong way. You probably are all aware of that there are really two types of life insurance. I always like to use a real estate analogy. Term insurance is like renting an apartment. You pay the rent, you get to live there. You stop paying the rent, they kick you out. Okay, term insurance, you don't own anything. You don't build any equity. You're basically paying for the life insurance, the death benefit. And typically today, you can get a guaranteed premium for 20, 30 years. And it's usually purchased by younger people who want to get a very low premium. It's much more cost effective. I generally recommend young people buy term insurance because they need a lot of insurance and they don't have a lot of budget to spend. They're paying for their kids' education. Permanent insurance is broken down into two categories. You probably all are familiar with the term whole life. Whole life has been around since like 1830. I think Mass Mutual is the first company to come out with a whole life policy. There are now new policies called universal life, very similar to whole life, but a little bit different in the fact that typically the premiums are less expensive and the cash value doesn't grow quite as rapidly. Whole life insurance was always used by financial advisors years ago as basically a retirement plan. You pay extra money, more premium, into the policy when you're younger because you want to have money later on in life. And you actually build equity. It's like buying a house. Over a period of time, you pay down your mortgage and you build equity. Well, a whole life policy or a universal life policy does build cash value. And as a result, you own it for your whole life. That's why they call it whole life. It's guaranteed for as long as you live. They can never take it away from you, as long as you pay your premium. And later on in life, a lot of business owners who bought whole life policies will actually strip the cash value out as part of their pension. You can do it on a tax-favored basis. So it's a way of having a supplemental pension plan. Well, now what the insurance companies have done, and this is kind of inside baseball with regard to the insurance industry, but we talked before about how the insurance companies are having difficulty because they're earning 1.8% on treasury bonds and they're guaranteeing to grow policies at 5%. So they're getting squeezed. So creative actuaries have come up with new types of life insurance policies, which include what's called an accelerated death benefit, where you can actually tap into your death benefit before you die on a tax-free basis to pay for long-term care. So now somebody who's in their 40s, 50s, or even 60s can buy a life insurance policy that builds cash value over time, but from day one, once they take the policy out, they're guaranteed their family's gonna get usually about 2 times their premium. You know, if you have a premium of $1,000 a year for a half a million dollar life insurance policy, typically, the even if you paid your premium for until you're 120, you're going to get back like 2 times death benefit what you put into the policy. And the way the insurance companies do that, obviously, is with investment returns. But now they've added these accelerated death benefit riders, which make it very, very attractive. Other riders that have been available for years, a children's rider. Very frequently, people would buy a policy and put their kids on for a few dollars a month, and they would get a little bit of life insurance for their children. Not that, you know, they want it, not ghoulishly, but, you know, God forbid something happened to the kids. They would have a little bit of money to bury them. Disability waivers are very, very possible, popular. You put a disability rider on your whole life policy or your universal life policy. If you become disabled, the insurance company keeps going and keeps paying the premium for you, and you're still building cash value even when you're not working and not paying into the contract. So those are very, very popular. You can add your spouse. You can the accelerated death benefit rider, the last one there, is what we're really focusing on this morning. Permanent life insurance allows you to take the cash value out for either to pay for long-term care. You can borrow the money out and pay it back. You can transfer. This is something a lot of people don't know. This is part of the federal tax code, which is kind of interesting. If you have a large life insurance policy you've owned for many, many years and you have a lot of cash value, you can strip the cash value out of that policy tax-free. Under a section of the tax code, the 1035 tax code section, you can use the cash value from your life insurance to pay for long-term care premiums or to pay for long-term care itself if you don't have a policy. So this is another way of accessing your cash value in your life insurance tax-free. But the link benefit is something that's, as I said, is relatively new, and it allows you to have the peace of mind of knowing that rather than buying a traditional long-term care policy, if you buy a life insurance policy with this long-term care rider, you're guaranteed to get a benefit. You're either going to die before you need long-term care and your family's going to get the $500,000 or whatever the policy is, or you're going to need long-term care and the death benefit is accelerated while you're alive to pay for your long-term care, and it comes out of the policy tax-free. So that's a very attractive component that a lot of people are now taking advantage of. There are some pros and cons, which I want to cover. First of all, the pros are, I think, outweigh the cons for the most part. It gives you a tremendous amount of flexibility. Instead of worrying about paying for a long-term care policy, you pay for a life insurance policy, and it's really like taking care of two risks with one premium. You're always going to have that death benefit, you're always going to have access to long-term care, and you could always take the cash value if you need it for a reason. The other main reason is that it can be funded in two different ways. Some people who are sitting with large sums of money in bank accounts and CDs earning no interest are very attracted to this vehicle. I have a lot of friends who are working for some of the large brokerage firms like Merrill Lynch, and they don't become experts on long-term care. They say to the client, are you worried about long-term care? Yeah. Well, we'll just take a $100,000 CD and we'll put it into this policy over here. A single payment will take care of all that, and you're guaranteed like 2.5 times the initial investment. The death benefit's going to be like $250,000 for a $100,000 deposit, and the long-term care benefit's going to be about $400,000. So it's really just taking lazy dollars that are earning almost no interest in a bank account and putting it into one of these policies. And it's going to protect your family two ways. It's either going to give them a death benefit when you go to heaven, or it's going to pay for your long-term care. And you might get a little bit of both, depending on, I mean, if you only need long-term care for a short period of time, it will not use up all the death benefit. So it's kind of like a very attractive vehicle. There are other folks who don't want to put a large sum of money in a single premium, so you can pay it annually, like a traditional long-term care policy. So those are the choices. That's basically it. I'll open it up to questions, and hopefully I can answer them all. And if not, my office is here on Franklin Avenue. Yes, sir. Dropping, I would say never, because the older you get, the more likely you're going to need it. I'm 68. I anticipate not needing my policy until the average 83, so I'm going to make sure I pay those premiums every year. I thought you were going to ask me when you can apply for it. The oldest you can apply is actually 84. Well, we've had people actually apply for it just before their birthday, when they were 84, you can actually apply for long-term care insurance as young as your 30s. It's kind of interesting. A lot of times families who are doing a financial plan with mom and dad, they get together and they're talking about preserving assets, and all of a sudden the adult children, like my daughter who's 44, she's in the process of buying long-term care insurance because we had a conversation at a soccer game yesterday out here getting sunburned on St. Paul's Field with my granddaughter, and now she's thinking about long-term care for herself because she says, well, it could happen to me. Yes. Yeah, that's actually a great question. There's an old Chinese proverb. When's the best time to plant a tree? 20 years ago. What's the second best time to plant a tree? Today. So the sweet spot is, if you think it's something, it's a risk you want to take care of, do it right away. But I find the average age of people applying for long-term care has been coming down significantly over the last 15 years because, number one, it's less expensive and easier to qualify health-wise, but also, so many times people are dealing as caregivers, like my sister-in-law. She was taking care of her mom for 10 years. Well, guess what? She bought a policy when that whole process started before her mom went to heaven. She bought a policy for herself. So if you're a caregiver or you're seeing the impact of long-term care, it's a trigger for doing it. But I would say probably prior to retirement, the insurance company, it's not like life insurance, which is lineal. Long-term care insurance premiums tend to go up in brackets. So probably the 55 to 65 category is kind of the vast majority of policies I sell. But you can, if you haven't done the planning and you're still healthy, you can do it up to 84. Yes?
You mentioned the 83 years old. That would be the age.
Well, that's the age when the average person goes on claim that has a long-term care policy.
I thought someone who was first buying it, I would think that would be astronomical.
Oh, it's very expensive. It is. But, you know, quite honestly, I had a woman in Malvern. She was a caregiver for her husband for many, many years who had Alzheimer's. And she was in her early 80s. And she said, I'm taking care of him, but if I get sick, all of our life savings is going to be spent on my care. So she bought a policy. It was about $10,000 a year, but she had plenty of money. And one thing that you probably noticed in some of the handouts, which I want to leave you probably the most important point of today. What is today? Tax day. Patriots Day. And we got an extension. Normally, Friday would have been the deadline to mail your check to the government. Today is the day. I actually have the checks made out in my car, ready to drop it in the post office today. New York State is the best place to buy long-term care insurance, not just because of the partnership plan. New York State realized that they were going broke in their Medicare system 25, 30 years ago. They came out with a program. Initially, it was a 10% tax credit. That means for every dollar you pay for a long-term care every year, they give you 10% back, not as a deduction, but as a credit. Well, about 5 years ago, they doubled it. Now it's 20%. So now when I pay my New York State taxes today, my wife and I, our combined premium for our two policies is about $5,000. Well, guess what? I get back $1,000 from the state of New York. 20% of my premium comes back to me in the form of a tax credit. And it's deductible on your federal return also. Now, for those people who are self-employed, have a subchapter S or a partnership, it's fully deductible. For folks who are not, who are just average citizens and don't have their own business, you get to deduct your long-term care premiums on your federal return as long as it falls into the normal deductible for medical expenses, 10% of your adjusted gross income. So if you're not self-employed, you may not be able to deduct on your federal return, but you can get 20% back in the form of a tax credit from the state of New York. And actually, one of the handouts I gave you on the flip side of, you may have noticed it, the handout that says long-term care protection, that's the longest one, on the backside is the IT-249. That's a state tax form that you just attach to your New York State tax form. And the second line, you'll notice there's a number 20, a decimal 20. You put on the number line number one, you put your actual premiums, and then you multiply by 20%, and line three is your tax credit. It's as simple as that. So the state, now why would the state give you 20% back on your long-term care? Does anybody have a clue? We talked before about Medicaid going broke. It's because if you buy long-term care insurance, you're not going to go on Medicaid. You're going to save the state millions of dollars. All states now have some sort of tax incentives for long-term care, but New York has the highest and the most aggressive because they have the biggest Medicaid budget deficit. They have big problems in New York State on their Medicaid. So they're trying to encourage people like you to consider long-term care insurance as part of your financial plan. Now, I don't say that everybody should have long-term care insurance, but everybody should have a long-term care plan. The plan can be going to an elder law attorney and transferring your assets and into an irrevocable trust. The plan could be maybe giving your assets to your kids in advance of an illness, but remember you have a 5-year look back. So long-term care insurance is not for everybody, but you should at least address the risk and think about protecting the dignity of yourself, receiving care, not being a burden on your children, and also protecting your life savings for your surviving spouse and hopefully an inheritance for the kids. Yes?
I just had a question on if you have an existing whole life policy in place, is it possible to add that linked benefit?
No. No, it's unfortunately a brand new type of policy, and the underwriter, actually that's a great question, because the underwriters, when you apply for one of these new policies, they do two types of medical underwriting. They do life insurance underwriting, which is mortality, how long you're going to live, and morbidity is the underwriting for long-term care. So there's actually double underwriting, medical underwriting for this new policy. You have to be healthy for a life insurance policy and healthy for a long-term care policy. So it's a little bit harder to qualify medically. But you can't add it to an old one, but you can do. If you have a whole life policy now, you can convert it. There's something called a 1035 exchange, which I mentioned before, where you can transfer the policy to a new linked benefit, and all the cash value you've accumulated in your old policy comes over to the new policy tax-free. So you can convert it, but you can't do it to the old policy. Okay. Right. The pricing has gone up significantly over the last few years because of that dynamic that I explained before about interest rates being so low. The insurance companies and the banks are suffering because the interest rates are so low. And I'm not writing an epitaph for the insurance companies. They're making a profit. But historically, what they were able to do was take premium dollars from people and go out and buy 5% and 6% treasury bonds. Hardly any risk. They're going to hold those bonds to maturity. Well, now they're getting less than 2% on those bonds. So the dynamic is much more difficult for them. So a lot of these insurance companies have exited the business, but regulatory-wise, they have to stand by those contracts. An insurance policy is an actual contract between you and the insurance company, and it's held up in law. So they can't renege on the benefits. They have to have enough money in reserves to pay those claims, even if they're not selling new policies. That's a great question. Yeah, the question was, of the few companies that are still selling traditional long-term care plans, what is the likelihood that their policy premiums are going to be the same? There's a big spectrum because of, basically, there's underwriting that's being done trying to figure out what to charge. So each company has a different underwriting department, so they come up with different formulas. The other thing that becomes a dynamic, does everybody know the difference between a stock company and a mutual company in the insurance business? Totally different structure. A stock company is like IBM or Ford. They sell stock. Well, there are a lot of insurance companies that demutualized, that became stock companies so they could raise money and grow. Mutual companies are actually owned by the policyholders. Companies like Mutual of Omaha, Mass Mutual, if they have mutual in the name, mutual benefit, they're mutual companies. That means that they're owned by the policyholders, not by stockholders. So their allegiance is more towards the policyholders. At the end of the year, when they have profits, they give dividends. Instead of giving a dividend to the stockholder, you get a dividend on your policy. I have my homeowners and auto insurance is with USAA. It's for the military, and they're a mutual company, and they pay every year. I get money back on my auto and homeowners insurance. If you bought a long-term care policy from Mass Mutual, you might pay a little higher premium for two reasons. Number one, it's the highest rated company. It's a AAA plus. It's a very solid company. But also at the end of the year, they might give you a little dividend back on your long-term care policy. So there are big divergences. One of the things, if you think about looking at long-term care, don't go to a captive insurance agent who works for one company. Not that they're bad people, but they're only going to show you one company. I've been, for about the last 25 or 30 years, I've been independent, and I have a program on my computer. It's actually this computer right up here. It's a proprietary program, and I can put every company side by side, put in your age, the premium, the benefit you want, the riders you want, and we can do a spreadsheet and show you what each company will charge for the exact same policy. And that way you get, you know, you get the best of shopping around without going online. Yes? Well, now there's really two types of long-term care plans. The New York State Partnership Plan is now only offered by two companies. Mass Mutual and Genworth are the only companies still offering the partnership plan, but there are about eight or nine total companies offering long-term care. And you can buy a traditional long-term care policy that's not a partnership plan and still get the 20% tax credit, but you're not going to get that Medicaid benefit at the back end. So, I mean, and again, it's just a question of, a lot of times it boils down to what's the prices. People look at these plans and they say, well, a New York State Partnership Plan requires you must buy inflation. You must have between a 5 or 3% inflation rider. That adds a lot to the cost of the premium. So if you say my budget is, I only want to spend $2,000 a year for my long-term care. If you look at a partnership plan, it might be a little bit above your budget. So you can buy a regular plan, maybe take a couple of the bells and whistles off of it, like the inflation protection. You maybe cut it down to 2% inflation instead of 3%. Those little numbers make a big difference in the premium because the insurance company is committing to you for the next 30 years. So the difference between 2, 3, 4, 5% inflation on the policy can make a big difference in the premium. Yes?
Yes. When it comes time for me to cash in for my long-term care.
Yeah. You were given the right advice. Whoever told you that gave you the right advice. I always typically, well, first of all, a lot of people in New York, they make a decision to leave New York when they retire or close to it, unless they have, you know, all their grandkids here. But the cost of care is so much less expensive outside New York. A three-year long-term care policy might last 6 years down in Atlanta because the prices are less. Because when you buy a long-term care policy, you're buying a pool of dollars. You take the daily benefit on your policy. Let's say you bought a policy with $200 or $250 a day for 3 years. Well, that generates about $250,000 to $300,000 of benefit. Well, you don't, when you file a claim, the insurance company is not going to give you $250 a day. They're going to reimburse you for what you actually spend. If you're spending $150 a day, your benefit's going to last longer because the pool of money is only being drained as fast as the cost is being reimbursed to you. But if you're in Atlanta or someplace else where the cost of care is less, a three-year policy with $300,000 of benefits could last 6 years. It could last longer than that. And that's another reason why people like to stay at home, because they can actually control the budget of what they're spending on their care. I have a client, a new client down in Rockville Center, right across from Malloy. She's 87, but she and her husband had the good sense to buy long-term care insurance a long time ago. And she's now finally qualified. She had a stroke. But this is something that this is getting into the weeds of the design of a plan. We all know that we have deductibles and coinsurance on our health insurance plans, right? You go to the doctor and you have to pay a $50 deductible or copay. Well, long-term care has a deductible, and it's called the elimination period. So when you buy the policy, you can select 30 days, you can select 0 days where the benefit starts right away when you qualify, 30 days, 60 days, 90 days. So that's the choice when you buy the policy, and it's a financial decision. Remember, we might get up to 100 days from Medicare, so why don't we take 100-day elimination and anticipate we might get some benefits from Medicare, because if you take 100-day elimination, your premium is much lower. So that's part of the design process when you buy the policy. But she just finally qualified for her benefits. She had a stroke about 3 months ago, but she didn't need much care. So she was having an aide come twice a week. And I said, no, have the aide come more often, because you got to spend down your assets anyway, and she has lots of money. But once you get on your benefit, the insurance company is going to start paying for your care. So you want to get through that elimination period faster, not wait for it. You had a question. Good advice.
To do that. And then I said to her, what else do you have? Said, well, I don't really want to pay this AARP. I said, no, yes, you do. Because you got grandfathered into a skilled nursing situation, which would take care of after the elimination period. That, I understand that.
That is huge. This gentleman was talking about an AARP policy that used to be offered. It's not offered any longer, but it used to have skilled nursing as part of a benefit under the AARP supplemental plan.
It's almost like a long-term disability.
It is, disability. Right.
Figure all of that stuff out. Here's another question. She has these beds from, literally from like when we were kids. And I said to her, I said, you might get back problems later on getting up out of these ridiculously old beds. Can she have Medicare? If it's written up by a doctor, said, oh, you got a bad back, go to Bob's Discount Furniture that, you know, allows you to, will Medicare pay for a bed?
They will. They will, and I have personal experience for this because I have, first of all, my mother-in-law had a Medicare bed in her living room on Kensington Road for 10 years, so I know that Medicare provides the bed. They provide the special mattress that they need.
When you say provide, that from their own source, or can you choose a source?
You can choose a source. They reimburse you up to a certain level, but basically Medicare wants you to stay at home. It's cheaper to keep you at home, so they're going to provide you the bed, the oxygen, the walkers. We had a Hoyer lift to get her out of bed. We had everything. We basically had a hospital room in her living room for 10 years. I have a client over on Suffolk Lane. They paid for a bed. They paid for a chair to help her get up. They have these new electric chairs where the chair actually sits you up and you can stand. So Medicare is actually very good with what's called durable medical equipment. They will pay for a lot of those things. You just have to ask.
Yeah, I think it's cheaper for the state to have people stay at home.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. And also, they bring it back again. You don't actually own it. It's there, but then when the person passes away, they come and collect the wheelchair and the bed and all that. They use it for somebody else. Yeah, it's durable medical equipment.
One other thing. I have a whole life with a disability rider. I happen to have had a knee replacement in my right knee. I had a battle with MetLife a little bit, and they said, well, you got to go through a 90-day elimination.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I argued about it. And I said, look, you know, what are you doing? What do you think is happening here? And besides, full knee replacement takes anywhere from 6 to 9 months. I mean, I'm fortunate, I'm kind of athletic, so I can recover a little quickly, but tough. I'm going to try and go the full max with something I already paid.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't quite understand, being self-employed, what I did, how I did it. But I explained, you know, why it was necessary to make the claim. A little stubborn about it.
Oh, yeah, well.
And people are very intimidated by insurance companies and say, well, you don't qualify, you don't do this. I'm saying to everyone here, fight.
Well,
if you don't fight, you don't get nothing.
Don't stick your insurance policy in a drawer someplace. Your insurance policy is a contract, okay? And the contract has language in it. So if you know your rights, and I've had many situations where I actually had to help people file claims. I've been selling long-term care policies for many, many years. A death claim is not something you're going to argue with. You know, you show them the death certificate, the person's going to heaven, right? But a long-term care plan or a disability a claim, those are a little bit harder. So if you have a relationship with an insurance agent who sold you the policy, they're going to go, basically that's their job, to provide the service and fight with the insurance company. So that, rather than you doing it yourself, I would call your agent to do that.
I went through the routine with the agent and all that. You know, hey, I'm having lunch, I'm going playing golf, but have a good time.
Yeah.
I went directly to the company.
As long as you got the contract, you're protected.
Well, I read it.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of people don't read stuff. And like you said,
or they lose their policy. You know how many times I've had to order replacement policies? People lose their policies. You had a question, sir.
Yeah. If you have a long term for 3 years, $200 a day,
right,
you end up staying home and it's only $100 expense,
right,
that would extend for 6 years?
That's right. Yeah, the think of your policy as a bucket of money, and you're going to drill a hole in the bottom of the bucket to start paying for your care. If you're taking out $100 a day for your care, the bucket drains more slowly. So the money stays there longer. So a three-year plan will become a six-year plan if you're only using $100 a day. So just think of it as your own money, and it's like an allowance, you know? And if you're very judicious on how you spend it and you're shopping around for a home healthcare agency that's a little bit more competitively priced, the biggest problem, believe it or not, in home healthcare agencies is finding somebody who you can feel comfortable leaving your loved one with. That's the hardest thing. I'm going through this with several of my clients right now where the agency sends somebody in. They either have a problem with the English language or they're not too ambitious. So as the customer with a home healthcare agency, you can continue to ask for new people until you find somebody you're comfortable with. That's very important.
And that's with all long-term policies?
Yes. All long-term care policies in New York State are certified. And you have to go to a home healthcare agency that is licensed by the state. You can't bring somebody in who is like your sister-in-law or an amateur. You have to have somebody who's got the home healthcare aide has to be certified and the agency has to be certified, or otherwise the insurance company is not going to reimburse you because they're fearful that you're going to get the wrong kind of treatment and then they would be liable. So they only reimburse for agencies that are licensed.
You mentioned before that the partnership is only set up with two insurance companies now?
Yeah, there's two companies that are offering it. About 3 months ago, a company called MedAmerica, who I actually have my policy with, they're up in Rochester, New York, they exited the business. They're no longer selling new policies. So now we have Genworth, which is the old General Electric insurance company, and we have Mass Mutual, which is a very solid, you know, AAA rated company. They're both offering partnership plans. MetLife, they don't offer it any longer, but they did. So if you have a MetLife policy, the great thing about the regulations in the insurance industry, if you have a policy that you bought years ago, it's a contract. They can't weasel out of that. So you're safe, even if the insurance company is not selling that policy anymore.
But it's not covered in the partnership.
No, when you buy a policy, you can decide to buy a regular long-term care plan or a partnership plan. That's a choice when you shop. The big problem with New York State, I mentioned before that booklet that's 10 years old. Also, to be a representative talking about the partnership plan, you have to take another course and you have to take an exam and you have to be certified for the partnership plan. A lot of insurance agents never bothered to do that. Only about 20% of insurance agents actually got certified to sell the partnership plan. As a result, when they're sitting down with you, if they're not certified to sell the partnership, they're not going to talk about it. They're only going to talk about what they can offer you. So that's a problem. There's a lot of insurance agents out there selling long-term care, and they never bother to get certified. So they're not going to discuss the partnership. Yes.
I know there's a lot of individual reasons, but what about when you talk about people who aren't qualified to be able to get long-term care insurance? With the advent of all this genetic testing that's out now, if you know that you have a predisposition for something, is that going to be held against?
That's a great question. It's interesting. I have a degree in biology, and I'm really paranoid about people sending their saliva samples off to some unknown company to give them their background about where their ancestors are. I think that's crazy. It's like sending your fingerprints off someplace. But no, if you know by genetic testing that you might be predisposed to something, but you have no symptoms, you're okay. The underwriting process for long-term care is very straightforward. It used to be never that they would even ask for a medical exam. Now some of them are actually asking for a medical exam. But the underwriting is basically when you sign the application, you're going to give the insurance company permission to go to your personal doctor, your primary care doctor, to get your medical records. That's it. And qualifying is not as hard as a lot of people think. I've had many people who have had heart conditions, who had diabetes that was under control, but their A1Cs were below 7. There's a whole list of questions that a well-trained advisor can go through to make sure you qualify. But if you have some minor
help. Say you have the BRCA gene. Say you know which is the breast cancer gene.
Right. Not for long-term care. That might be an issue for life insurance if it's in your medical records. Long-term care insurance, think about this. The underwriting for life insurance and long-term care are opposite. Long-term care, they're worried you're going to live too long. You're going to linger. Life insurance, if you die from cancer young, so the life insurance guys are going to be worried about that gene. Long-term care guys... Yep.
So we'll be
in. Okay. Oh, congratulations. My phone number's on the handouts. Okay, thank you. Any more questions? Yes, sir.
Are you able to check the primary care doctor, you said?
Basically, if you are receiving any kind of prescription drugs on the application, they're going to ask which doctor prescribed it. So if you're going to a primary care doctor, but then let's say you went to a cardiologist because your primary care doctor thought you should be taking some statin drugs for high, cholesterol, they would ask for medical records from all of your attending physicians who have prescribed medicines. But if you don't have a chronic illness, or if you have a chronic illness that's being managed, like a good example is diabetes or hypertension, those, if they're being managed, you can get a long-term care policy.
Is it more expensive because you have something?
That's a good question. It really depends on the severity of the illness and the longevity of the illness, how long you've been treated for it. And I don't want to give you a blanket answer, but I have had a lot of people who were managed well under blood pressure and diabetes who got standard policies. You're not going to get a preferred policy if you're taking 3 or 4 different meds. And the difference between preferred and standard ratings is about 10%. Very, very few people actually qualify for preferred. Not that you have to be a marathon runner, but about 15 or 20% of applicants get a preferred policy based on the fact that the normal height and weight, no prescription drugs, no history of chronic illness, but the vast majority of people, almost 80% of policies are issued as standard. There are some companies that offer substandard policies which are more expensive, but the folks that have those issues that they're dealing with are glad that they get that policy because the choice is a substandard policy with a 20% higher premium or no coverage at all. So there's some insurance companies that are a little bit more lenient, and it's interesting too, if you deal with somebody who specializes in this field, some insurance companies might be really okay with blood pressure, but other companies are not. Some companies might say, well, if you smoke and you have blood pressure, we don't want you, but another company. So each company has its own sweet spot in terms of the medical underwriting. So depending on your particular set of facts, we can match that up to a company that actually...
Only two
companies for a partnership, right.
And what's the positive... What's the
biggest benefit of the partnership plan, I thought I enumerated that. Yeah, it's at the end. Think about this. When you buy a partnership plan, whether it be in New York or Tennessee or wherever they offer them, you're buying a traditional long-term care policy from an insurance company. But at the back end, and this only applies to a certain small fraction of the population because you have to use your whole policy. You have to qualify for benefits. You have to be receiving care for 3 or 4 years, depending on the policy length that you bought. And then at the end, if you're still alive and you still need care, Medicaid, welfare pays for your care without having to give away your assets. So it's not a lot of people that actually qualify. What I call it is it's peace of mind insurance. It gets you knowing that because you can buy a policy with a 5-year benefit or a 7-year benefit. They used to offer lifetime benefits. My wife and I bought lifetime benefits because we dealt with it in our family. So if I need care for 20 years, the insurance company's got to pay for mine. But you can't buy lifetime anymore, but you can get up to about a 7-year policy, but it gets expensive. So now you're making decisions. I may and I may not need long-term care. I have a budget. I've got kids going to college. How much am I going to really want to spend on long-term care? So it's really a financial planning decision as well as, you know, peace of mind and knowing you'll have some protection later on in life. I always say, this is probably, there's two sayings that I always try and close with. The first is, if you have some form of long-term care, I call it it's anti-nursing home insurance. Nobody wants to go to the nursing home, but if you have a private policy, it allows you to stay at home longer. So it's anti-nursing home insurance. The other statement I like to say is, it's better to have some protection. If you know that it's going to cost $250 a day for home care, why don't you buy a policy with $100 a day? You can copay the rest out of your income, but at least this way you know that you've covered some of the risk. It's better to have a half a loaf than no loaf at all. And so it's really a pragmatic decision when you sit down with your financial advisor. What's your budget and what you think your risks will be? Did you have a question?
Yeah, I have a question. When the policies first came out, there were 3-year policies.
Yes, that's correct.
Because they said, well, if you're going to a nursing home, you give all your money away.
Right.
There's a 3-year look back.
That's right.
Now it's a 5-year look back.
That's exactly right.
So you avoid estate tax. But they're talking about eliminating estate tax?
Well, no. The transfer of assets was not to avoid estate taxes. It was avoiding the Medicaid going after your assets. That's another big problem of people doing estate planning. If you're doing estate planning and you have a lot of resources, right now the exemption is over $5 million per person.
It's 5.4 change from the federal.
From the federal.
4.18.
And New York is gradually catching up to the federal. So between a husband and wife, you'd have to have north of about $10 million to worry about estate taxes. It used to be a big problem.
But what if you're still living after 5 years?
After 5 years,
$2 million.
Right.
They come after that?
You're still in a nursing home. No, only if you're trying to apply for Medicaid. If you're trying to apply for Medicaid and you had a 5-year policy, and the day you bought the policy, you transferred all your assets. Now some people have done that. They do a Medicaid trust, they give away their assets, but now they have a 5-year window where they're not protected. So they buy a policy. You can buy a policy with a 5-year benefit. And after the 5 years that the money's in the trust, you can let the policy lapse because now you're qualified for Medicaid. You don't have to keep paying the premium on the long-term care after the first 5 years. So you're covering the window of risk with the insurance until your Medicaid trust is safe. And so that's a strategy a lot of elder law attorneys recommend. You do a combination of a Medicaid trust and a long-term care policy that you let go after 5 years. And then you're not paying the premium for the rest of your life. You're only paying it for 5 years. Yes? Well, young lady over here said wanted me to address the lobbyists for the insurance industry. It's kind of like the lobbyists for the medical industry, the pharmaceutical industry, the lumber industry, the oil and gas industry. They all have lobbyists. As a matter of fact, K Street down in Washington is basically where they all live. And that's one of the reasons why our tax code, our federal tax code, is like this. Because every special interest that has money has a lobbyist, and they get a special piece of the tax code that carves out something special for their industry. But the insurance industry is very heavily regulated by the state government, and now it's also regulated by the federal government for long-term care. And I'll reiterate, which I think I said before, the single best place to buy any type of insurance is New York. The New York Department of Insurance is the strictest in terms of financial regulations, in terms of reserving money for claims. If you ever stay up late at night and you have difficulty sleeping, do you ever watch some of these commercials for some of these cheap long-term life insurance policies on late night shows? If you read the bottom mice type on the TV screen, it always says not available in certain states. Well, New York has probably several thousand insurance companies that decide not to do business in New York because the regulations are so much higher here. For example, when they collect money from you, they have to put into a reserve fund to pay claims. It's less profitable. So New York requires more money reserved for claims than any other state. There are guys called actuaries that work for the state insurance department. There are about 100 actuaries in the entire United States working for insurance companies, insurance departments. Out of 100 actuaries nationally, 50 of them are domiciled in New York. So we have half of all the actuaries and inspectors controlling the insurance industry right here in New York. So, and also, I have a lot of clients who have decided they're going to retire and move to Florida or Virginia or someplace else. Before you move, buy a policy in New York because it goes with you. It's portable. All the regulations that are on your policy that you bought in New York, they go wherever you go. And if the insurance regulations in Florida are lax, it doesn't apply to you because you bought a policy that's domiciled in New York. That's always on the application. Where was this application signed? The agent has to put down New York as the application location. You had one more question.
Just on the partnership.
Yes. That's a great question. I'm surprised nobody asked that already. Basically, the insurance company is creating a policy that's identical to a non-partnership plan. They don't have any financial responsibility to pay the Medicaid at the back end. That's the state of New York. So they're going to price it the same. If you have a $200 a day policy with 3 years of benefits, partnership, non-partnership, it's going to be about the same. And I can show you in a spreadsheet. They're identical. What you're getting, the benefit you're getting at the back end is from the state of New York. Not from the insurance company. So it doesn't cost them anything to do it.
Did you say, I'm sorry, I missed the very beginning of the presentation, but is there a finite time that partnership's going to be offered?
Well, that's a very good question. When it first started, there were 8 companies offering the partnership plan. Now it's down to 2. And that's a function of the fact that a lot of insurance companies are getting out of long-term care. But I suspect the primary company right now is Genworth. You may or may not have heard of it. It's the old GE company. Genworth is the largest writer and has been since the beginning of time for long-term care. If you look at what they call the market share, John Hancock is number 2, and Genworth is like 3 times bigger at number 1. They're the 800-pound gorilla. So they're probably going to always stay in the business that they keep saying they're going to, and they have the partnership plan. The other company, which I'm very enamored with, is Mass Mutual. But Mass Mutual is significantly more expensive because they have their pricing structure to pay out dividends. You know, they're a dividend-paying company. So I would say the likelihood the partnership plan will be around for a while, I hope. Nobody knows. When MedAmerica left the business, I was so surprised because they were the first company to join the partnership plan, and they don't write any other kind of insurance. MedAmerica, which is part of Blue Cross Blue Shield up in upstate New York, they only sold long-term care. They didn't have auto insurance or life insurance. They only did long-term care. So they've exited selling policies, but they obviously are going to service their existing clientele. You had one more question, or did you? No? I think I covered all the questions. Thank you.